Grace and peace to you. Good morning. And welcome to you. Welcome to all. If you're visiting this morning, please know how glad we are you're here. No matter who you are, no matter where you are on this journey, you are welcome here just as you are. This is an open and affirming congregation of the United Church of Christ. We also say good morning and welcome to those of you watching the service on local television, and we wish you God's peace. We do gather downstairs after worship for a time of fellowship and refreshment. Please do join us if you're able, and we will certainly be able to welcome those of you who are visiting more warmly there. Now, there are several announcements in the insert this morning. The first is actually an amendment to the first announcement. Islam in America Today, a panel discussion, has been rescheduled. It will be next Sunday, same time, 4 to 5:30. But rather than Ilsley Library's meeting room, it will actually be right here. The meeting room at the library is not available next Sunday afternoon. So next Sunday, 4 to 5:30, right here. Hope that you can make it. Monday's Bible study, I suppose, is a little bit in question, depending on how this winter snowy forecast bears out. I'm hoping it does. It's been like 5 years since we've had snow. So, and I know there are children in this room right now. It might cross your mind that it's a snow day-ish kind of feel to it, right? All right. I've made the prediction that we'll have a snow day. I just want that to be known. Anyway, this will, the reason I'm digressing, if school is canceled in the ACSU district tomorrow, Bible study will be canceled. I figured if it's not safe enough for our kids to go to school, then please stay home, and we'll start our Bible study the following week. Okay, so just pay attention to that. On Wednesday, Al Zakor will convene a group to discuss best-selling book, Hillbilly Elegy, in Fellowship Hall, 7:30. Whether you've read it or have just started to read it, if you're interested in that book, please do come. We'd love to have you there. Two more things. These beautiful flowers are in memory of Sue and George Saul. We celebrated Sue's life here yesterday. Thank you to the Board of Pastoral Care and the deacons for your support yesterday. And on page 2 of this insert, you can see that there is something of a contest going on to name the all-purpose room in the addition. Your submissions are certainly welcome. Pastor Andy's Playhouse is not allowed, okay? But other than that, please feel free to use your creativity, come up with something beautiful, because it's right now, it's the community room, the all-purpose room, the big room. We could do better than that. So we're asking for your brilliant minds to come up with something better. Okay, would you please join me now in a time of prayerful centering silence. Thank you.
Please join me in the reading of the call to worship. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace.
Where there is hatred,
let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon.
Where there is doubt, faith.
Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy.
May I not so much
seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand,
to be loved
as to love. For it is in giving that we receive. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned.
None of us has it all figured out. None of us is perfect. But in this house of prayer, in this community of faith, we remind one another that we are loved, not only by brother and sister, but by God. With confidence in that love that cannot change, let us look clearly at our lives. Let us name those parts of our lives that need adjustment and change. With confidence in God's grace, please join me in our prayer of confession. Gracious God, we acknowledge to you our sin. The truth is, our lives do not always mirror your beauty. The profit and pleasures we pursue lay waste the land and pollute the seas. The fear and anger we harbor set neighbor against neighbor and nation against nation. Forgive us our words and actions that tear the fabric of community. Forgive us our love withheld and forgiveness refused. Enliven our hearts and minds, O God, so that we may practice your reconciling love with wisdom and courage. Through Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Jesus says, "Come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest." Through Jesus Christ, God offers grace and peace. You are loved, you are forgiven, you belong to God.
Good morning. I'd like to invite the children forward for a message, please. Good morning. Uh-oh, I lost some of my props. All right, I got them back. How are you guys doing? Good. All right, so we have been working on the fruits of the Spirit this year, right? Okay, and this month we're on our sixth fruit. Does anybody remember how many total we have? Rachel? Nine. Okay, can you guys help me again so that we can help the congregation review? Can you help me? All right, so who just remembers one of the fruits? Not the actual fruit you eat, the word that we live by, that God helps us to be better people. Baker? Patience. All right, come on up. There you go. Patience. All right, Asher. Okay, joy. Oh, I keep losing my props. You can stand right next to Baker. All right, Rachel. Love. I think love fell down. Come on over. We'll pick it back up. There you go. All right, Eva. Peace. All right. Anybody remember last month's? We did random acts of kindness. Claren, would you hold kindness for me? All right, thank you, ma'am. All right, awesome. So, we've got all those. Are they in order? Who remembers the first one? Baker, what was the first one? Love. All right, Rachel, you switch with Claren. All right. Then what came after love? Joy. Ooh, the audience is participating. Excellent. All right, guys, they're learning. All right. So love and joy. What was next? Anybody? Peace. All right, move around. Awesome. And after peace? Patience. And then kindness. Anybody know what we're doing this month? Goodness, for goodness sakes. Excellent. All right, Stella, can you please hold that up there for me, ma'am? Thank you. All right, so far we have love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness. And these are things that God wants us to incorporate into our lives so that we can live a better life, right? That's what this is all about. All right, you guys are awesome. You can take the fruits and just sit down with them for the moment. I have some other things, some other props in my bag we need to work on. All right, hold on a second. Okay, so we're going to talk a little bit about goodness today. And I brought some blocks to demonstrate goodness. You guys excited? All right. So I'm going to make this really cool tower of all the good things I do. So I go to church every Sunday. I made some cookies for fellowship hour. Well, the junior youth group did. I just kind of supervised. Taste them when you go down today. They're going to be delicious. I called a sick friend. How are we doing? I helped a stranger find their keys. Ooh, I made myself. Okay, it's all right. I think I can make this happen. All right. I prayed for a mean person. All right, so my tower of goodness fell. Do you know why, besides the fact that I'm not good at stacking blocks? Because the foundation wasn't really based on goodness. It was based on gloating, right? God doesn't want us to be good and do good things for other people so that we can sit around and brag and boast about them. God wants us to do good things because it's the right thing to do, right? So if you have a foundation where you realize goodness is about helping other people for the benefit of them, not for you, so you can look good and be all impressive, that's what real goodness is. This room, these people, brimming with goodness, overflowing. There are so many people in this room that do sneaky, secret little things for other people that no one knows about, and they do not want credit for it, and they do not want attention for it. They understand the goodness, okay? All right, will you join me in a prayer? And then we'll take our fruits and we'll go next door. All right. Dear kind and giving Lord, thank you for all the goodness that I have received and that I'm able to give. Please help me to remember to be helpful and good to others because it's the right thing to do, not because it makes me look good. Guide me as I try to include all the fruits of the Spirit in my daily living. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The first reading today is from Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 to 17. As God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Bear with one another, and if anyone has a complaint against another, forgive each other. Just as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you are called in the one body. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Teach and admonish one another in all wisdom. And with gratitude in your hearts, sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs to God. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God through him. Amen.
Our second lesson is from the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 5, beginning with the 21st verse. Over the past few weeks, we have explored the beginning, anyway, of the Sermon on the Mount, and this passage continues in that vein. Jesus is speaking now to his disciples. You have heard it was said to those of ancient times, you shall not murder, and whoever murders shall be liable to judgment. But I say to you that if you are angry with a brother or sister, you will be liable to judgment. And if you insult a brother or sister, you will be liable to the council. And if you say, you fool, you will be liable to the hell of fire. So when you are offering your gift at the altar, if you remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother or sister, and then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you are on the way to court with him, Or your accuser may hand you over to the judge, and the judge to the guard, and you'll be thrown into prison. Truly, I tell you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny. Here ends the lesson. Would you please pray with me? Gracious God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Tommy loves Legos. Tommy wants to play with Legos. Tommy wants to play with those Legos right now. But Johnny loves Legos too, and Johnny is already playing with those Legos. So at this point, things could go a few different ways. Seeing the glint in Tommy's eye, Johnny could look away and pretend that Tommy isn't standing there. And Tommy, seeing Johnny immersed in Legoland and the practice of avoidance, could walk away with a quivery lower lip. Or Tommy's love for Legos could grow so hot that he lunges for the Legos. And Johnny could hover over his Legos like a lion over his kill. And the two boys could brawl until the teacher breaks it up and makes them both sit in Lego-free corners for the rest of their lives. Or Tommy and Johnny could use their words. If Tommy is feeling brave, he could ask Johnny, "Can I play too?" To which Johnny could say, "Not right now, maybe when I'm done." Or, "Yes, that would be fun." And if Johnny is feeling charitable, he could anticipate Tommy's question and say, "Hey Tommy, would you like to play Legos with me?" These three outcomes are just a few possibilities. Given your imagination and your experience with young children, I am sure you could come up with more. But however this drama plays out in our minds, we all know conflict is part of life. Lego conflict is real, but really just the beginning. Conflict is with us from nursery school to nursing home. I don't expect you to celebrate that this morning. Conflict is stressful. It's uncomfortable. Who wants that? Fair enough. But without conflict, I think life would be pretty dull. And I know we would be very short on stories. I mean, if Sam I Am convinced that other guy to try green eggs and ham on page one, there would be no story. I do not like green eggs and ham. I do not like them, Sam I Am. That's conflict. That's what drives the story along its twisted road. So the truth is, conflict is just baked into the stories we read and write and tell. And conflict is woven through the lives we live. It isn't that we go looking for trouble. It's that trouble has no trouble finding us. We did not set out this morning to choose conflict. But throughout the day and the days ahead, we will choose how to deal with it. Because sometimes things fall apart. And when conflicts come, we have choices to make. We have options. One option is do nothing. Let bygones be bygones. Leave the past in the past. Let's get on with the business of living in the present. That's one way to go. And honestly, I've gone there so many times, I can walk the path of avoidance with my eyes closed. Get over the damage done? No problem. Steer around confrontation? Gladly. Now, maybe these are the markings of white Anglo-Saxon Protestant. Or maybe it's human nature. Conflict is, by definition, unresolved, and we love resolution. It's much easier to sweep the broken pieces under the bed, along with everything else we don't want to see. So not dealing with conflict is one way to deal with conflict. But this approach just doesn't get us very far, does it? Bygones aren't really gone until we deal with them openly and honestly. Conflict doesn't go away because we say, go away, conflict. Conflict doesn't just disappear when we gloss over the differences or we paper over the cracks. So maybe a more active approach to conflict would suit us better. Like, get even. Yes, retaliation and revenge are options for dealing with conflict. You offend me, I offend you. You push me, I push you. You club me over the head, I club you over the head. And round we go. This is a very old and popular dance. It's been said that revenge is sweet, but not fattening. But you don't need to be a master chef of conflict resolution to know that revenge does not satisfy us for long. Retaliation does not put an end to conflict. It does not repair the breach. It does not help us hear what the other person is saying. I mean, sure, we've all nibbled here and there on the empty calories of revenge, but deep inside, we know there's a better way. Not do nothing, not get even, but be reconciled. Reconciliation is a third option, a third way of life. It's active, too. The word itself means to bring back together. To bring back together. And if you have ever tried this, you know how much effort it takes. In the words of Desmond Tutu, true reconciliation is based on forgiveness, and forgiveness is based on confession, and confession is based on contrition for what you have done. We know that when two friends have quarreled, one of them must be ready to say the most difficult words to say in any language, I'm sorry. And the other must be ready to forgive. Now, given all that he did, at great risk to himself, to unify South Africa, we know Tutu's words are not merely theoretical. And given his deep roots in the church, we know his words are not his words alone. True reconciliation is what Jesus teaches. In today's reading from the Sermon on the Mount, Christ himself says, if your brother or sister has something against you, do not do nothing. Do not get even. If your brother or sister has something against you, Leave your gift before the altar and go. First be reconciled with that brother or sister. Then come and offer your gift. Now, why do all that? Why go to all that trouble? Because the quality of our relationships matters to God. Our relationships are where God with us dwells. And if this is as true as I believe it to be, I'd like to ask you to do two things before I sit down. You can close your eyes, you can leave them open, whatever makes you more comfortable. First, call to mind a relationship in your life that is really important to you. A connection that is healthy and whole and good. A bond that is strong enough to sustain you. I'd like to invite you to hold that person's face in your mind's eye and to thank God for him or her and for the connection you two share. Now, think of another relationship that is really important to you, but one that has suffered some damage, one that has lost its way, grown a little cold, one that drains you when you think about it, drains you a little or a lot. Well, I'd like to invite you to pray for that person. And pray for yourself. To pray for healing and well-being in that relationship. So is this all we need to do? No. True reconciliation will require much more of us than that. But it's a start, a good start. And as distant as the possibility may seem today, as crazy as it may sound today, I do want to say, as simply and as clearly as I know how, God is in that hope for reconciliation. And God is in that hard work of reconciliation. And God is in that happy reunion. Amen. At this time, I invite you to share from your well of blessings, dip a cup in, and pour it into the lives of others. Share as you are able to share for the strength and love of this ministry and its effort to reach out well beyond these walls. Thank you. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for all the gifts that flow into and through our lives. We thank you, God, for the goodness of this day, this community, and this moment. We thank you, God, for this opportunity to share our gifts as we're able, so that more people and more places will know faith, hope, and love. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. As we enter this time and place, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Go forth into the world to serve God with gladness. Be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor all people. Love and serve God, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. The grace of Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.